Hi, this is Tom Rhodes. Please join me as I scour the four corners of the earth to bring you interesting and intelligent funny people who will enrich your life with wisdom and laughter. I'll take you to Europe, Australia, all over America. I might take you to the peaks of Machu Picchu, the canals of Amsterdam, the Great Wall of China, or the swamps of Florida, and certainly the many, many comedy clubs and comedy theaters all over the world. Come hang out with me and meet the many interesting people that pop up in my life as I travel the world as a stand-up comedian.
You're listening to Tom Rhodes Radio.
Karate kick, baby.
Rock and roll.
Welcome to Tom Rhodes Radio Smart Camp. Today, I am going to fill your head with smartness. Your brain will be bursting with intelligence by the time we finish this episode together. Today's episode is about Guy de Maupassant. As you know, I am a Francophile, the first love of my life, Nathalie from Paris, who I've talked about many times on this show. Her and her mother introduced me to some of the greatest luxuries in the world that I think a human being could enjoy. That's the writings of Voltaire, the music of Vivaldi, Veuve Clicquot Champagne, and the short stories of Guy de Maupassant. Maupassant, as we would pronounce in American, because we pronounce every letter, that's why it's difficult for Americans to speak French, I guess. The guy's name, his first name is Guy, G-U-Y. In French is pronounced Guy. So I have many Maupassant books. It's easy to find complete works, books of his complete works. Whenever I'm in a used bookstore through the years, I'll always, if I see a Maupassant book, I'll grab it. To pick up one of his books for $1 or $2 is a steal, because you can open it up to pretty much any story and it's going to knock you out with the descriptions of nature, human nature, the twists of the stories. And the guy is just a master storyteller, and storytelling is basically one of the greatest things in life to penetrate our dark little hearts. And you know, I've bought these his books through the years, and I'll give them to friends, and it's just a perfect gift if you ever see a book. So let me tell you a little bit about the man himself, Guy de Maupassant. This is from Wikipedia. Henri René Albert Guy de Maupassant was a French writer, remembered as a master of the short story form and as a representative of the naturalist school of writers, who depicted human lives and destinies and social forces in disillusioned and often pessimistic terms. Maupassant was a protege of Flaubert, and his stories are characterized by an economy of style and efficient, effortless outcomes. Many are set during the Franco-Prussian War of the 1870s, describing the futility of war and the innocent civilians caught up in events beyond their control and are permanently changed by their experiences. And isn't that what we want from a story? We want to hear stories about people who are changed permanently by their experiences. And here's an interesting little tidbit before we move on to his works. Maupassant was one of a fair number of 19th century Parisians, including Alexander Dumas, who did not care for the Eiffel Tower. And he often ate lunch in the restaurant at its base of the Eiffel Tower, not out of preference for the food, but because it was only there that he could avoid seeing it, seeing its otherwise unavoidable profile. So he ate lunch at the Eiffel Tower almost every day, and he said the reason why he ate lunch at the Eiffel Tower because it was the only place in Paris where you didn't have to look at it. Interesting. Funny. He's an interesting guy. There's this other short story master, a Jewish man from Odessa named Isaac Babel, who I would place right after Maupassant. And in the future, I would like to do an episode all about Isaac Babel. But I bring him up just to tell you, I have the complete works of Isaac Babel, and he wrote a short story involving Guy de Maupassant. And this paragraph perfectly describes the life that you should know about Maupassant before we kick in to the man's works. So Isaac Babel, interesting guy. He was Jewish. He was from Odessa. He believed in the Communist Party and the revolution. And he actually wrote propaganda for the Communist Party of Russia. And what did he get in return? Stalin killed the fucking guy. Hey, thanks, cock. Anyway, Babel was a badass unto his own. And so the fact that Babel idolizes this guy says it all. And this is from Isaac Babel's short story involving Maupassant. He had read a biography on Maupassant by Edouard de Menial. Maupassant was born in 1850 to a Norman nobleman and Laurie Lee Poitainvin, Flaubert's cousin. At 25, he had his first attack of congenital syphilis. He fought the disease with all the potency and vitality he had. In the beginning, he suffered from headaches and bouts of hypochondria. Then the phantom of blindness loomed before him. His eyesight grew weaker. Paranoia, unsociability, and belligerence developed. He struggled with passion, rushed about the Mediterranean on his yacht, fled to Tunis, Morocco, and Central Africa, and wrote unceasingly. Having achieved fame, he cut his throat at the age of 40. Did you catch that? Having achieved fame, he cut his throat at the age of 40. Bled profusely, but lived. They locked him in a madhouse. He crawled about on all fours and ate his own excrement. The last entry in his sorrowful medical report announces, Monsieur de Maupassant is degenerating to an animal state. He died at the age of 42. His mother outlived him. Wow, fucking heartbreaking. It's hard to imagine, like, when people achieve fame, like Robin Williams or Anthony Bourdain, who just decide to kill themselves. But syphilis was eating his brain. It was untreatable in the 1800s. And I only learned in recent years or in recent months that I didn't know anything about Maupassant's life until recently. I had only cherished his short stories. So it's pretty interesting that, like Van Gogh, the guy went nuts and killed himself and was put into a nut house at the end of his life. People who gave the world such great works of art to die in such a helpless, pitiful manner. And to think of Maupassant crawling around on all fours, eating his own shit like a dog is pretty heartbreaking. But I want you to get that out of your pretty little brains, because the man's work should be celebrated. Thank you, Isaac Babel. I'll put that big book over there. I was going to start with Ball of Fat, but let's, you know what? Let's do this right. Because this story, and I had to download this from the internet. Oddly enough, I couldn't find this story in any of the books that I have. The very first Maupassant book I ever read had this story in it, and it's pretty powerful. Here, let's just read it. Here we go. This is called Idle. The train had just left Genoa en route for Marseille. and was following the long curves of the rocky coast. It slithered like an iron snake between the mountains and the sea, past beaches of yellow sand, lapped by little silver waves, before being swallowed up into the mouth of a tunnel like an animal bolting into its lair. In the last carriage, a plump woman and a young man were sitting opposite each other in silence, stealing the odd surreptitious glance at each other. She was about 25 and sitting on the door side of the carriage, looking out at the passing scenery. She was a stocky, chubby-cheeked Piedmontese peasant woman with black hair and a full bosom. Having pushed several partials under the wooden seat, she was now holding a basket on her knees. The young man was about 20, very thin with the deep tan of someone who works in the fields under a blazing sun. Beside him, tied up in a bundle, was his entire fortune: a pair of shoes, a shirt, a pair of breeches, and a jacket. Under his seat, he had stowed a pick and a shovel tied together with a rope. He was hoping to find work in France. The sun, as it rose, poured a rain of fire over the coast. It was late May, and delightful fragrances filled the air and wafted through the lowered carriage windows. Orange and lemon trees in blossom breathed upwards into the peaceful sky, sweet, pervasive, honeyed scents, which mingled with the perfume of the roses growing wild along the track. Rambling over the rich gardens, they passed around the doors of the tumble-down country cottages, and in the open country too. This coast is their natural habitat. They fill the place with their light yet powerful fragrance, and turn the air itself into something both sweeter than wine and equally intoxicating. The train was moving slowly, as it wanted to linger and savor the gentle charm of this Eden. It kept stopping at small stations where a few white houses stood. Then, after giving a long whistle, it continued on its leisurely way. No one ever got on. It was as if the entire population was dozing and reluctant to move at all on that hot morning in spring. From time to time, the plump woman's eyes would droop, then quickly fly open, as she just managed to save the basket from falling off her knees. She would examine the contents for a while, then nod off again. Beads of sweat stood like pearls on her forehead, and she was breathing with difficulty, as if she were suffering from some painful constriction. The young man's head had fallen forward on his chest, and he was sleeping the deep, sound sleep of a country lad. Suddenly, as they were leaving a small station, the peasant woman seemed to revive. Opening her basket, she took from it a hunk of bread, some hard-boiled eggs, a flask of wine, and some beautiful crimson plums. She began to eat. The young man, having also woken, watched her, following the progress of each mouthful from her knees to her lips. He sat with his arms folded, his eyes fixed and his own lips pressed together. His cheeks were hollow. The woman ate with huge gusto, swigging at the wine flask greedily to help the hard-boiled eggs down. Then, stopping to get her breath back, she devoured the lot, the bread, the eggs, the plums, and all the wine. As soon as she had finished her meal, the boy closed his eyes again. The woman loosened her bodice to be more comfortable, and he suddenly looked up at her again. With not a trace of self-consciousness, she went on unbuttoning her dress. The pressure of her bosom stretched the fabric so that, as the opening widened, the flash of white undergarment and a little of her skin were revealed. Feeling much more at ease now, the woman said in Italian, "So hot you can't breathe hardly." The young man replied in the same language and with the same accent as her own. "Good weather for traveling." "You from Piedmont?" she asked. "Asti." I'm from Casale. Immediately, they started chatting together as neighbors. For some time, as it is often the case among ordinary people not much used to making conversation with strangers, their exchanges were stiff and formal. Then they discussed local affairs and discovered mutual acquaintances. As the list of people they had each recently bumped into grew, the two became friends. Brief, hurried words with sonorous endings fell from their lips in lilting Italian. They moved on to personal matters. She was married with three children, who were now in the care of her sister. She herself had found a good job as a wet nurse to a French lady living in Marseille. The woman was looking for employment. He, too, had been told he was sure to find some in Marseille, since apparently there was a good deal of construction work on offer. Then they fell silent. The heat beating down furiously on the carriage roofs was becoming unbearable. A cloud of dust raised by the train drifted in. The smell of the orange and lemon trees, as well as of the roses, became stronger, yet more pervasive and heavier. The two passengers fell asleep once more. When they opened their eyes again, it was simultaneously. The sun was sinking towards the sea and casting a brilliant sheen on its blue waters. The air freshened and became a touch lighter. Even with her bodice loosened, the wet nurse was panting. Her cheeks looked flabby and her eyes lackluster. She said in a weak voice, "I haven't given the breast since yesterday. I feel so giddy with it, almost faint." Not knowing what to say, he made no reply. When a woman produces as much milk as I do, she has to give the breast three times a day. If not, it gets very painful. It's like a weight pressing down on me. Stops me breathing. Does me in. That much milk's a real problem. "I'm sure," he said, "it must be a nuisance for you." She did look in a very bad way indeed, as if she might pass out at any minute. "I've only got to press for the milk to come gushing out like a fountain. It's amazing, unbelievable. At Casale, all the neighbors used to come and watch." "Oh, really?" he said. "Yes, really. I'd show you now, only it wouldn't be any help to me. Not enough comes out that way." She fell silent. The train stopped at a little halt. Standing behind the barrier was a thin woman dressed in rags and carrying a baby crying in her arms. The wet nurse looked at her sympathetically. "Now there's a woman I could help, and that baby would give me some relief, I can tell you. I'm not a rich woman, else I wouldn't be leaving my home like this, and my people and my darling little youngest to find work away. But I'd give 5 whole francs quick as a flash to have that kid or 10 minutes, to have that kid for 10 minutes and give it the breast. I'd be a new woman." Again, she fell silent. Several times she raised her hot hand to wipe her forehead, which was dripping with sweat. She groaned. "I can't stand it anymore. I'll die in a minute." With an unself-conscious movement, she opened her dress completely, revealing her enormous tout right breast with its brown nipple. The poor woman was moaning. "Oh my God, I don't know what to do. What can I do?" The train had set off again and was continuing its journey amid the flowers, whose fragrance now deepened in the warmth of the evening. From time to time, a fishing boat would appear, sleeping on the surface of the blue sea. Its motionless white sail reflected in the water like its own double upside down. Embarrassed, the young man stammered, "Madam, perhaps I could help you." In a broken voice, she replied, "Oh, yes, if you will. That'd be great help. I really can't stand it anymore." He knelt down in front of her. She leaned towards him with a practiced gesture, pushed the dark tip of her breast towards his mouth. With the movement she made with both hands to proffer her breast to the man, a drop of milk appeared at the crown. He licked it greedily. Then, as if on a fruit, closed his lips on the heavy breast. Regularly and deeply, he began to suck. He put both arms around the woman's waist so as to bring her closer to him and drank in long, slow draughts, making movements with his neck like a baby. Suddenly she said, "There, that's enough on that side. Take the other one now." Obediently, he moved to the other breast. She put her two hands on the young man's back and was now breathing deeply and contentedly, enjoying the fragrance of the flowers mingled with the gusts of air that blew into the carriage as they moved. "Smells lovely round here," she said. He made no reply and continued to drink at the human fountain. His eyes closed as if to savor the pleasure of it. Gently, however, she pushed him away. "That's enough. I feel much better now. It's put new life in me." He got up, wiping his mouth with the back of his hand, as she replaced inside her dress the two living gourds of her bosom. She said, "That was a great help, monsieur. Thank you very much." Gratefully, he replied, "My pleasure, madam. I'll tell you, I've had no food for 2 days." Wow. The guy got to suck on a big titty on a train ride. What a fantastic story. Where do we go from there? Should we take a break? Does everybody need to take a cold shower? This guy is such an incredible writer. And this next story, I don't know if you want to hit pause and take a cold shower. And we are back. Hey, I had to take a break after that last story. I recorded the last story about 5 days ago. And then I started to read the next story, and I just couldn't get that image out of my head as I started to read the next story about that guy, about the woman breastfeeding the guy on that empty train car. Just something about a nipple in your mouth. It stays in your mind. So that's the power of Maupassant. His stories just stay with you. So I actually had a problem with my old microphone and went back to Guitar Center. Always get the warranty, people. And I have an upgrade now. I have the H5 Zoom for recording purposes. So hallelujah. Shitty microphone is no longer in my life. So I don't know if you had to take a break after that last story, but we're ready to keep going with the one and only Guy de Maupassant. This story is called Doubtful Happiness. I can tell you the name neither of the country nor of the man. It was far, far from here, upon a hot, fertile coast. We followed, since morning, the shore and the wheat fields and the sea covered with the sun. Flowers grew down near the waves, the light waves, so sweet and sleepy. It was very warm, but a gentle heat, perfumed with the fat, humid, fruitful earth. One could believe that he was breathing germs. That's a strange sentence. I had been told that this evening I would find hospitality in the house of a Frenchman who lived at the end of the promontory in the grove of the orange trees. Who was he? I do not know yet. He had arrived one morning, 10 years before this, bought land, planted his vines, and sown his seed. He had worked, had this man with passion and fury. Month after month, and year after year, he had added to his domains, making the fertile virgin soil yield without ceasing, and amassing a fortune by his indefatigable labor. It was said that he had worked constantly, up with the dawn, going through his fields until night, superintending everything without rest. He seemed harassed by a fixed idea, tortured by an insatiable desire for money, which nothing could distract or appease. Now he seemed to be very rich. The sun was setting when I reached his dwelling. This dwelling was at the end of a point in the midst of orange trees. It was a large square house, very simple, overlooking the sea. As I approached, a large bearded man appeared in the doorway. Having saluted him, I asked for shelter for the night. He extended his hand and, smiling, said, "Enter, sir. You are at home." He led me to a room, gave some orders to a servant with the perfect ease and good grace of a man of the world. Then he left me, saying, "We will dine when you are ready to come down." We dined upon a terrace opposite the sea. At first I spoke of his country, so rich, so far away, so little known. He smiled, answering in an abstracted way, "Yes, this is a pretty country, but no country pleases one much when it is far from those they love." "You regret France?" I long for Paris." "Why not return there?" "Oh, I am going to return there." And gradually we began to talk of the French world, of the boulevards, and of the many features of Paris. He asked me about men he had known, cities, names, all of them familiar names upon the vaudeville stage. "Who does one see at the Tortoni's these days?" "The same ones, except the dead." I looked at him with marked interest, pursued by some vague remembrance. Certainly I had seen that head somewhere, but where and when? He seemed fatigued, although vigorous, sad, though resolute. His great blonde beard fell upon his breast, and sometimes he would take it near his chin and draw it through his closed hands, slipping it along to the very end. He was a little bald, but had thick eyebrows and a heavy mustache, which mingled with the hair of his beard. Behind us the sun was disappearing into the sea, throwing upon the coast a cloud of fire. The orange trees, in flower, exhaled a powerful, delicious fragrance on the evening air. Seeing nothing but me, and fixing his look upon me, he seemed to discover in my eyes, to see at the depths of my soul, the well-known, much-loved image of the broad walk, so far away, that extends from Madalena to the Rue Druat. "Do you know Borte?" he asked. "Yes, certainly." "Is he much changed?" "Yes, he is all white." "And the Ridami?" "Always the same." "And the women? Tell me about the women." "Let us see. Did you know Susanna Werner?" "Yes, very well, to the end." "Ah, Sophie Astier." "Dead." "Poor girl. Can it be? Did you know?" He was suddenly silent. Then in a changed voice, his face growing pale, he continued, "No, it is better not to speak of her. It disturbs me so." Then, as if to change the trend of his thought, he rose and said, "Do you wish to go in?" "I am willing to go," and I followed him into the house. The rooms downstairs were enormous, bare, sad, and seemed abandoned. Some glass dishes were set upon the table by the tawny-skinned servants, who constantly roamed around the dwelling. Two guns hung upon two nails on the walls, and in the corners were to be seen some spades, some fish lines, dried palm leaves, and objects of every kind, placed there at random by those entering, that they might find them at hand should they chance to have need of them going out. My host smiled. "This is a lodge, or rather the lodging place of an exile," he said, "but my chamber is more as it should be. Let us go in there." I thought, on entering, that I was in a curiosity shop. So filled was the room with all kinds of things, things disconnected, strange and varied, that one felt to be souvenirs of something. Upon the walls were two pretty engravings of well-known paintings, some stuffs, some arms, swords, pistols. Then, in the middle of the principal panel, a square of white satin in a gold frame. Surprised, I approached to look at it, when I perceived a pin which held a hair in the middle of the shining silk. My host placed his hand on my shoulder and said, smiling, "That is the only thing that I see here, and the only thing I have seen from 10 years. Madame Prodhum exclaims, "This sword is the most beautiful day in my life." But I say, "This pin is all of my life." I sought for a commonplace phrase and ended by saying, "You have suffered through some women." He replied, "You may say I have suffered miserably, but come out on my balcony. My name has suddenly come to my lips. A name has suddenly come to my lips that I have not dared to pronounce, because if you had answered dead, as you did when I spoke Sophia Astier, my brain would be on fire even today." We were upon a large balcony where we could see two gulfs, one on the right and the other on the left, shut in by high gray mountains. It was the hour of twilight, when the sun, entirely out of sight, no longer lights the earth, except by reflection from the sky. He continued, "Do you know if Jean de Lemours still lives?" His eyes, fixed on mine, was full of trembling anxiety. I smiled and answered, "Yes, indeed, and prettier than ever." "You know her?" "Yes." He hesitated, then asked, "Completely?" "No." He took my hand. "Tell me about her," he said. "I have nothing to tell. She is one of the most charming women, or rather, girls, in Paris, and the most courted. She leads an agreeable, princess-like existence. That is all." He murmured, "I love her," as if he had said, "I am going to die." Then, "Ah, for 3 years, that was a frightful but delicious existence of ours. I was very near killing her 5 or 6 times, and she tried to put out my eyes with that pin we're just looking at. Wait, do you see the little white point under my left eye? That shows how we loved each other. How can I explain this passion? You could never comprehend it. There should be such a thing as simple love, born of the force of two hearts and two souls. And assuredly, there is such a thing as an atrocious love, cruelly torturing, born of the invincible rapture of two beings totally unlike, who detest while they adore each other. This girl ruined me in 3 years. I possessed 4 millions, which she squandered in her calm way, tranquilly, and destroyed with a sweet smile, which seemed to fall from her eyes upon her lips. You know her? Then you know that there is something irresistible about her. What is it? I don't know. It is those gray eyes, whose look enters into you and remains there like the barb of an arrow. Or is it rather that sweet smile, indifferent and seductive, which stays on her face like a mask? Her slow manner penetrates little by little and takes hold of you like a perfume, as does her tall figure, which seems to balance itself as she passes, for she glides instead of walking. And her sweet voice, which drags a little, and is so pretty that it seems to be the music of her smile. Her gestures, too, are always moderate gestures, always right, which intoxicate the eye. So harmonious are they. For 3 years, I only saw her upon the earth. How I suffered, because she deceived me as well as everybody else. Why? For no reason. Only for the sake of deceiving. And when I found it out and accused her of being a street girl, a bad woman, she said tranquilly, "Well, we are not married, are we?" Since I have come here, I have thought much about her and have succeeded in understanding her. That girl is Menon Luscat over again. Menon could never love without deceiving, and for her love, pleasure, and money were all. He was silent. Then after some minutes he added, "Well, I had squandered my last sou for her simply. For her, she simply said to me, 'You understand, my dear, then I cannot live on air and weather. I love you very much. I love you more than anyone, but I must live. Misery and I can never dwell in the same house.' and if I could only tell you what an atrocious life I led by her side. Whenever I looked at her, I had as much desire to kill her as I had to embrace her. Whenever I looked at her, there came to me a furious desire to open my arms, press her to me until I strangled her. There was something about her, behind her eyes, something perfidious, unseizable, which made me furious against her, and perhaps it was for that very reason that I loved her so much. In her, the feminine, the odious, frightful feminine, was more prominent than in any other woman. She was charged and subcharged with it. As with a venomous fluid, she was woman, more than anyone else has ever been. And whenever I went out with her, she would cast her eyes over all men in such fashion that she seemed to give herself to each one with only a look. This exasperated me, but attached me more strongly to her, nevertheless. This creature belonged to everybody. From merely passing through the street, in spite of me, in spite of herself, from her very nature, although the allurement was most modest and sweet, do you understand? And what torment! At the theater, in a restaurant, it seemed to me that everyone possessed her before my eyes, and whenever I left her alone, others did, in fact, possess her. It is 10 years now since I saw her, and I love her now more than ever. Night had spread over the earth. A powerful perfume of orange flowers was in the air. I said to him, "Will you try to see her again?" He answered, "Surely. I have here now, in money and land, 7,000 or 8,000 francs. When the million is completed, I shall sell all and set out. With that, I can have 1 year with her, one good entire year, and then, adieu, my life will be finished." I asked, "And after that?" "After that," he answered, "I don't know. It will be finished. Perhaps I shall ask her to take me as a valet de chambre." Wow. Okay, that guy was clearly a fool. Let me have a sip of coffee, sitting in the sunshine at my desk, reading some Maupassant to the Rhodesies, to my smart camp friends all over the world. The coffee has lost its hot. More lukewarm coffee. Okay, so got two more Maupassant stories I want to read to you. It's interesting that, you know, he spent so much time traveling and just imagining stories. That was his life. The way I try and think of jokes everywhere. And I travel in order to gain experiences so I can have the best stories. But I tell stories from my perspective and how it affected me. This guy was just inventing scenarios and stories from any idea, or it's pretty amazing. And then to think that the guy died batshit crazy, walking around on all fours in a nut house, is pretty sad. Okay, this story is called Julie Romaine. In the springtime 2 years ago, I was walking along the shores of the Mediterranean. What is more charming than to dream while walking over a lonely road? One enjoys the sunlight and the caressing wind when climbing the mountains or strolling by the sea. One enjoys the sunlight and the caressing wind when climbing the mountains or strolling by the seashore. And in his daydreams, what illusions, what love poems, what adventures pass in 2 hours through the mind of one who idles along a road. Every possible hope, confused and joyous, penetrates him with the warm light air. He inhales them with the breeze, and they give birth in his being to an appetite for happiness, that increases like the hunger he acquires in walking. Sweet and fleeting thoughts sing in his soul as he comes closer to nature. Wow, what a beautiful opening paragraph that is. Shall I read it again? No, we shall continue. I followed the road that leads from St. Raphael to Italy, or rather, I made my way through the superb and changing scenery, which seems made to be celebrated in all the love poems of the earth. It seemed to me a pity to think that from Cannes to Monaco, scarcely anyone comes into this part of the country, save to make trouble, to juggle with money, or to display under this delicious sky, and in this garden of roses and oranges, base vanities, stupid pretensions and vile covetousness, and to show the human mind as it is, fertile, ignorant, arrogant, and grasping. Suddenly, in one of the curves of the ravishing bays, I saw a group of villas, four or five only, fronting on the sea at the foot of the mountain. Behind them was a wild forest of pines, which covered two great valleys, apparently without roads or outlet. Involuntarily, I stopped in front of the gate at one of the chalets. So pretty was it. A little white cottage with brown decorations, covered with roses that climbed the roof. The garden was filled with flowers of all colors and every size, coquettishly arranged in studied disorder. The lawn was dotted with flower beds. A vase with trailing vines stood on the step of the veranda, and over the windows hung clusters of purple grapes, while the stone balustrade that surrounded this charming dwelling was covered with enormous red morning glories that looked like spots of blood. Behind the house stretched a long alley of orange trees in flower, which reached as far as the foot of the mountain. On the door of the villa, in small gilt letters, I read this name, Villa de Anton. I asked myself what poet or fairly inhabited the place. I asked myself what poet or fairy inhabited the place. What inspired recluse had discovered it and created this dream of a dwelling that appeared to spring from masses of flowers. A workman was breaking stones on the road at a short distance. I asked him the name of the proprietor of the chalet. He replied that it belonged to the famous Madame Julie Romaine. Julie Romaine? In my childhood, I had often heard her spoken of, the great actress, the rival of Rachel. No woman had been more applauded or more loved above all. How many duels had been fought, and how many suicides had been committed because of her, and how many wild adventures had been undertaken for her sake. What was her age now, the seductress? 60? No. 70? 75 years? Julie Romaine, here in this house. I recalled again the emotion created throughout France. I was 12 years old then. By her flight to Sicily with one lover, a poet, after her notorious quarrel with another adorer. She fled with her new love one evening after a first night representation during which the audience had applauded her for a half an hour and called her out 11 times in succession. She went away with the poet in a post-chaise, as was the custom then. They had crossed the sea in order to love in that antique island, daughter of Greece, under the immense grove of orange trees that surrounded Palermo, which is called Conque d'Ove. Their ascent of Etna was gossiped about, and also how they hung over the immense crater, arm in arm, cheek against cheek, as if they desired to throw themselves into the gulf of fire. He was dead now, the writer of affecting verses, of poems so brilliant that they dazzled a whole generation, and so subtle and mysterious that they opened a new world to other poets. The other lover was dead also, the abandoned one, who created for her those musical expressions that remain in all hearts, expressions of triumph and despair that are at once intoxicating and heart-rendering. She lived here, in this house, veiled with flowers. I hesitated no longer. I rang the bell. A domestic came to open the door, a boy of 18 years, awkward and shy, with hands that appeared to be in his way. I wrote on my card a gallant compliment to the old actress and an ardent prayer that she would receive me. Perhaps she might know my name and allow me to see her. The young valet disappeared, but soon returned and asked me to follow him. He showed me into a neat drawing room, correct in every detail, in the style of Louis Philippe, with furniture of a cold and cumbersome fashion, the coverings of which were being removed in my honor by a little maid of about 16 years, with a slender figure but not much beauty. Then the servants left me alone. I looked around the room with interest. On the walls hung three portraits. One was of the actress in a celebrated role. Another was of the poet lover wearing a long frock coat, tight at the waist, and the ruffled shirt of those days. And the third was of the musician seated before a clavichord. The lady was blonde and charming in her portrait, but her pose was a little affected, as was the fashion of that day. Her charming mouth and blue eyes smiled graciously, and the technique of the painting was of a high degree of excellence. Those three remarkable faces seemed to be looking already at the next generation. Their surroundings had an air of a day that was past and of individualities that were no more. A door opened, and a little woman entered. She was very old, very small, with eyebrows and bands of white hair. Somehow she reminded me of a white mouse, quick and furtive in her movements. She gave me her hand, and with a voice that was still fresh, vibrating and sonorous, she said graciously, "Thank you, monsieur. It is very kind of the men of today to remember the women of yesterday. Be seated." I told her that her house had attracted me, that I had tried to learn the name of the proprietor, and having learned it, I could not resist the desire to ring her bell. "Your visit gives me the greater pleasure, monsieur," she said, "as it is the first time such an event has happened. When your card was handed to me with the gracious compliment it carried, I was as startled as if someone had announced an old friend who had been gone 20 years. I am forgotten. Truly forgotten. No one remembers me. No one will think of me until the day of my death, and then all of the papers will talk for 3 days of Julie Romaine, telling anecdotes, giving details and souvenirs and scandals and perhaps pompous eulogies. Then that will be the end of me." She was silent a moment and then resumed, "And that will not be long now. In a few days, perhaps, the little woman who is now alive will be nothing but a corpse." She raised her eyes to her portrait, which met her gaze as if smiling at that withered caricature of itself. Then she looked at the two men, the scornful poet and the inspired musician, both of whom seemed to say, "What does that ruin ask of us?" An indescribable, keen and irresistible sadness seized my heart, the sadness that overwhelms those whose lives are finished and who struggle still with memories, as of a drowning man struggles in deep water. From the place where I sat, I could see brilliant and swiftly moving carriages passing along the road, going from Nice to Monte Carlo, and seated inside were beautiful young women, rich and happy, and men smiling and satisfied. She followed my glance, and comprehending my thought, murmured with a resigned smile, "It is not possible to be and to have been at the same time." "How beautiful life must have been for you," I said. She sighed deeply. "Yes, beautiful and sweet. It is for that reason that I regret it so much." I saw that she was disposed to talk of herself, so softly and with delicate precautions, as one would touch a painful wound, I began to question her. She spoke of her success, of her intoxicating joys, of her friends, of her whole triumphant existence. Of her whole triumphant existence. Your greatest joy and your deepest happiness. Did you owe them to the theater, madame? I asked. Oh, no, she replied quickly. I smiled and she added, raising her eyes with a sad look to the portraits of the two men. I owe my greatest happiness to them. I could not refrain from asking her to which one she owed it. To both, monsieur. I even confuse them in my mind sometimes. And besides, I feel remorse toward one of them to this day. Then, madame, is it not to them, but to the act of love itself, that you owe your gratitude? They have merely been love's instruments. That is possible, but ah, what wonderful instruments. You are certain that you have not been loved, that you would not have been loved as well, and perhaps better, by a simple man, one who was not great, but who would have offered you his whole life, his whole heart, his whole being, every thought and every hour. With those two, you had two formidable rivals, poetry and music. She cried out with force, with that youthful voice which could still thrill the soul. No, monsieur, no. A simple man might have loved me better, perhaps. But he would not have loved me as those two did. Ah, but they knew how to sing the music of love, as no other man in the world could have sung it. How they intoxicated me. It is possible that any other man could have found that which they found in words and in sounds. It is enough to love if one does not know how to put into love all the poetry and all of the music of the sky and the earth. They knew, those two, how to make a woman ecstatic with joy, and with their songs and their words as well as with their deeds. Yes, there was perhaps more of an illusion than reality in our passion, but those illusions lift you to the clouds, whereas realities alone always leave you on the earth. If others loved me more, it was through them alone that I learned, felt, and adored love. Suddenly she began to weep, noiselessly tears of bitter sorrow. I appeared not to notice it, and looked far away out the window. After a few moments she went on. You see, monsieur, with most people the heart grows old with the body. With me that has not happened. My poor body is 75 years old, but my heart is only 20, and that is the reason why I live all alone, with my flowers and my dreams. Again a long silence fell between us. After a time she calmed herself and again spoke smilingly. How you would laugh at me, monsieur, if you knew how I pass my evenings when the weather is fine. I am ashamed of my folly and pity myself at the same time. It was useless for me to beg her to tell me. She would not do so. Then I rose to go, at which she cried, What? So soon? I told her that I had intended to dine in Monte Carlo, and at once she asked, a little timidly, Would you not like to dine with me? It would give me very much pleasure. I accepted her invitation immediately. She appeared delighted and rang the bell. Then, when she had given a few orders to the little maid, she said she would like to show me her house, a kind of glass-covered veranda, full of plants, opened from the dining room and permitted one to see, from one end to the other, the long alley of orange trees, extending to the foot of the mountains. A low seat, hidden under the shrubbery, indicated that the aged actress often came here to sit. Then we went into the garden to look at the flowers. Evening came on, softly, one of those calm, warm evenings that brings forth all the perfumes of the earth. It was almost dark when we placed ourselves at the table. The dinner was excellent, and we sat long over it. We became quite intimate friends. A profound sympathy for her had sprung up in my heart. She drank a glass of wine and became more friendly and confidential. "Let us go out and look at the moon," she said at last. "I adore the moon, the lovely moon. It has been the witness of my greatest joys. It seems to me that all my sweetest memories are treasured there, and that I have only to look at it in order to have them come back to me. And sometimes, in the evening, I arrange for myself a pretty scene. So pretty, if you only knew. But no, you would laugh at me too much. I cannot tell you. I don't dare. No, no, I cannot tell you." "Ah, madame, continue, I pray," I begged of her. "What is your little secret? Tell me. I promise you not to laugh. I swear it." She hesitated. I took her hands, her poor little hands, so thin and cold, and kissed them one after the other many times, as her lovers were wont to do in former days. She was moved, though she still hesitated. "You promised me not to laugh," she said timidly. "Yes, I swear it, madame." "Well, then come," she said with a smile. We rose from the table, and as the awkward youth in green livery do back in the chair behind her spoke a few low, quick words in his ear, he replied respectively, "Yes, madame, immediately." She took my arm and led me upon the veranda. The orange tree walk was a beautiful sight. The moon cast a slender line of silver among the trees, a long line of light that fell on the yellow sand between the dense and rounded branches. As the trees were in bloom, their delicious and penetrating perfume filled the air, and among the dark foliage were thousands of fireflies, whose tiny flames looked like the seed of stars. "Oh, what an ideal environment for a scene of love," I cried. She smiled. "Is it not? Is it not? You will see presently." She made me sit down beside her and murmured, "The memory of such scenes is what makes me regret life. You hardly dream of those things, you men of today. You are merely money makers, businessmen. You don't know how to talk to us even. When I say us, I mean women who are young. Love affairs have become merely liaisons, which originate often in an unacknowledged bill of the dressmaker. If you find the bill more important than the woman, you disappear. But if you esteem the woman of greater value than the bill, you pay. Nice manners and charming affections." She took my hand. "Look," she said. I was astonished and transported with pleasure at the charming picture that appeared. Below us, at the end of the alley, in the full moonlight, a youth and a maiden were coming towards us, clasping each other around the waist. They advanced, their arms entwined, walking slowly in the moon's rays, the soft effulgence of which bathed them completely. They disappeared in the darkness for a moment, then reappeared further down the avenue. The youth was dressed in a white satin costume of the last century, with a broad hat over which hung an ostrich feather. The maiden wore a skirt with wide hoops, and her head was dressed with the high powdered coiffure affected by beautiful dames in the days of the Regency. At last they came to a halt about 100 steps from us, and, standing in the middle of the alley, they embraced, after saluting each other gracefully. Suddenly I recognized the two little servants. Then I was seized with one of those irresistible desires to laugh that shake one all over. I did not laugh, however. I resisted the impulse and waited to see the next scene in this extraordinary comedy. The lovers now returned toward the end of the alley, and distance again made them appear charming. They withdrew further and further away, and at last disappeared like the figures in a dream. The alley seemed lonely without them. I took my departure also. I left immediately, so that I should not see them again, for I thought it probable that the spectacle was made to last a long time, in order to recall all the past, that past of love and scenic effect, that fictitious past, deceiving and seductive, falsely, yet truly charming, to cause the tender heart to throb again in the romantic breast of the old actress, and to use me as a final instrument. Wow. Boom. Maupassant, baby. He always talks about perfumed air, and he mentions orange trees a lot. Maybe that's why I like Maupassant. But these are definitely great stories for the summertime. Okay, this is the last story I'm going to read you today, and I invite you to go find some Maupassant books in thrift stores and used bookstores and read them for yourself. This last story I'm going to read for you is called Femme Fatale. let me sip some cold coffee and then I'll continue. Definitely cold. All right, can you smell the orange perfumed air? Okay, Femme Fatale. Me. The restaurant, La Grillion, mecca of the entire local boating community, was now slowly emptying. At the main entrance, a large crowd of people were calling and shouting out to each other, with oars on their shoulders. Strapping great fellows in white jerseys waved and gesticulated. Women in light spring frocks were stepping cautiously into the skiffs moored alongside and, having settled themselves into the stern of each, were smoothing out their dresses. The owner of the establishment, a tough-looking, red-bearded man of legendary strength, was helping the pretty young things aboard, and with a practiced hand was holding steady the gently bobbing craft. The oarsmen then took their places, playing to the gallery and showing off broad chests and muscular arms in their sleeveless vests. The gallery, in this case, consisted of a crowd of suburbanites. I'm sorry. The gallery, in this case, consisted of a crowd of suburbanites in their Sunday best, as well as a few workmen and some soldiers, all leaning on the parapet of the bridge and watching the scene below with keen interest. One by one the boats cast off from the landing stage. The oarsmen leaned forward and with a regular swing pulled back. At each stroke of the long, slightly curved blades, the fast skiffs sped through the water, making for La Grenouillière and growing progressively smaller till they disappeared beyond the railway bridge and into the distance. Only one couple now remained, the slim, pale-faced young man, still a relatively beardless youth, had his arm around the waist of his girl. A skinny little grasshopper of a creature with brown hair. They stopped from time to time to gaze into each other's eyes. The owner cried, "Come on, Monsieur Paul, get a move on." The couple moved down closer. Of all the customers, Monsieur Paul, who'd paid regularly and in full, was the best liked and the most respected. Many of the others ran up bills and frequently absconded without settling them. The son of a senator, he was also an excellent advertisement for the establishment. When some stranger asked, "And who's that young chap over there with his eyes glued on that girl?" one of the regulars would murmur in a mysterious, important sort of way, "Oh, that's Paul Barron, you know, the son of the senator." Then the stranger would inevitably comment, "Poor young devil, he's got it bad." The proprietress of Le Grillion, a good businesswoman and wise in the ways of the world, called the young man and his companion "my two turtle doves," and looked with tender indulgence on the love affair which brought such glamour to their establishment. The couple ambled slowly down to where a skiff called the Maddalena was ready. Before embarking, however, they stopped to kiss once more, much to the amusement of the audience gathered on the bridge. Finally, Monsieur Paul took up the oars and set off after the others, also making for La Grenouillère. Sorry, I can't pronounce French towns. When they arrived, it was getting on for three. When they arrived, it was getting on for three, and here, too, the vast floating cafe was swarming with people. It is, in effect, one huge raft with a tarpaulin roof supported by wooden columns. It is connected to the charming island of Croisset by two narrow footbridges, one of which runs right through the center of the cafe itself. The other connects at the far end with a tiny islet where a single tree grows and which is nicknamed the Pot de Fleurs. From there, it connects with the land again via a bathing pool. Monsieur Paul moored his boat alongside the cafe, climbed up to the balustrade, then, holding his girl's two hands, guiding her up also, they entered, found a place for two at the end of a table, and sat down opposite each other. Lining the towpath of the opposite side of the river was a long string of vehicles. Fiacres alternated with the flashy carriages of gay young men about town. The first were lumbering great hulks, whose bodywork crushed the springs beneath, and to which were harnessed broken-down old hacks with drooping necks. The other carriages were streamlined, with light suspension and fine, delicate wheels. These were drawn by horses with slender, straight, strong legs, heads held high, and bits snowy with foam. Their solemn, liveried drivers, heads held stiffly inside huge collars, sat ramrod straight with their whips resting on their knees. The river banks were crowded with people coming and going in different directions, different kinds of configurations. Family parties, groups of friends, couples and individuals. They idly plucked at blades of grass, wandered down to the water's edge, then climbed back up to the path. Having reached a certain spot, they all congregated to wait for the ferryman, whose heavy boat plied constantly back and forth, depositing passengers on the island. The branch of the river, incidentally, called the Dead Branch, which this floating bar dominates, seemed asleep, so slowly did the current move there. Flotillas of gigs, skiffs, canoes, paddleloos, and river craft of all kinds streamed over the still water, mingling and intersecting, meeting and parting, running foul of each other, stopping, and with a sudden jerk of the oarsmen's arms and a tensing of their muscles, taking off again, darting this way and that, like shoals of red and yellow fish. More were arriving all the time, some from Chatou upstream, some from Bougival downstream. Gales of contagious laughter carried from one boat to another, and the air was full of insults, complaints, protestations, and howls. The men in the boats exposed their muscular tanned bodies to the glare of the sun, and like exotic water plants, the women's parasols of red, green, and yellow silk blossomed in the sterns of their craft. The July sun blazed in the middle of the sky, and the atmosphere was gay and carefree, while in the windless air not a leaf stirred in the poplars and willows lining the banks of the river. In the distance ahead, the conspicuous bulk of Mont Valérien loomed, reading the ramparts of its fortifications in the glare of the sun. On the right, the gentle slopes of Louvencinez, following the curve of the river, formed a semicircle within which could be glimpsed through the dense and shady greenery of their spacious lawns. The white painted walls of weekend retreats. On the land adjoining La Grenouillère, strollers were sauntering under the gigantic trees, which helped to make this part of the island one of the most delightful parks imaginable. Busty women, with peroxide hair and nipped-in waists, could be seen, made up to the nines, with blood-red lips and black, cold eyes. Tightly laced in their garish dresses, they trailed in all their vulgar glory over the fresh green grass. They were accompanied by men whose fashion plate accessories, like gloves, patent leather boots, canes as slender as threads, and absurd monocles, made them look like complete idiots. The part of the island facing La Grenouillère is narrow, and between it and the opposite bank, where another ferry plies, bringing people over from Crossy, the current is very strong and very fast. Here it swirls and roars, raging like a torrent in a myriad of eddies and foam. A detachment of pontoon builders, wearing the uniform of artillerymen, was camped on the bank, and some of the soldiers, side by side, on a long beam of wood, sat watching the river below. A noisy, rambunctious crowd filled the floating restaurant. The wooden tables, sticky and awash with streams of spilt drink, were covered with half-empty glasses and surrounded by half-tipsy customers. The crowd sang and shouted and brawled. Red-faced, belligerent men, their hats tipped at the backs of their heads and their eyes glassy with booze, prowled like animals spoiling for a fight. The women, caging free drinks in the meantime, were seeking their prey for the night. The space between the tables was filled with the usual clientele, noisy young boating blades and their female companions in short flanneled shirts. One of the men was banging away at the piano, using his feet as well as his hands. Four couples were dancing, a quadrille, and watching them was a group of elegantly dressed young men whose respectable appearance was ruined by the hideous incongruity of the setting. The place reeked of vice and corruption, and the dregs of Parisian society in all its rottenness gathered there. Cheats, con men, cheap hacks, rubbed shoulders with underage dandies, and old ruse and rogues. Sleazy underworld types, once notorious for things best forgotten, mingled with other small-time crooks and speculators, dabblers in dubious ventures, frauds, pimps, and racketeers. Cheap sex, both male and female, was on offer in this tawdry meat market of a place where petty rivalries were exploited, and quarrels picked over nothing in an atmosphere of fake gallantry where swords and pistols at dawn settled matters of highly questionable honor in the first place. Every Sunday, out of sheer curiosity, some of the people from the surrounding countryside would drop in. Every year would bring a fresh batch of young men, extremely young men at that, keen to make useful contacts. Casual cruisers would amble by, and every so often a complete innocent would become embroiled. La Grenouillère lived up to its name. There was a place for bathing between the tarpaulin-covered raft, where drinks were served, and the pot de fleurs. Women, with the requisite curves, came there to display their wares and their clients. Those less fortunate, who required padding and corsetry to pass muster, looked disdainfully on as their rivals cavorted and splashed about. Awaiting their turn to plunge in and thronging around a small diving board were swimmers of every shape and size. some slim and straight as vine poles, some round as pumpkins, some gnarled as olive branches, some with bodies curved forward over pot bellies, some whose vast stomachs threw the body backwards. Each was as ugly as the other as they leapt into the water and splashed the customers drinking at the cafe next door. Despite the proximity of the river and the huge trees shadowing it, the place was suffocatingly hot. Mingling with the fumes of spilt drinks came the smell of flesh and the cheap perfume with which the skin of those trading in sex was drenched. Underlying all these smells was the slight but persistent aroma of talc, which wafted with varying intensity as if an unseen hand were waving some gigantic powder puff over the entire scene. All eyes were on the river, where comings and goings of the boats attracted everyone's attention. Girls sprawling in the stern opposite their strong-wristed menfolk looked with contempt at those still prowling about the island in search of a male to buy them dinner that night. Sometimes when a crew in full swing flashed past their friends ashore, would shout and were joined by the crazy yelling crowd inside the restaurant. At the bend of the river near Chateau, boats were constantly coming into view. As they approached and grew more distant, faces became recognizable and more shouts went up. A boat with an awning and containing four women came slowly downstream towards them. The woman at the oars was small, lean, and past her prime. She wore her hair pinned up inside an oilskin hat. Opposite her, a big blonde, dressed in a man's jacket, was lying on her back at the bottom of the boat, with a foot resting on the thwart on either side of the oarswoman. The blonde was smoking a cigarette, and with each jerk of the oars, her bosom and her belly quivered. At the very stern of the boat, under the awning, two beautiful women, tall, slender girls, one blonde and the other brunette, sat with their arms round each other's waists, watching their two companions. A shout went up from La Grenouillière, "Aye, aye, Lesbos!" And suddenly, a wild clamor broke out. In the terrifying scramble to see, glasses were knocked over and people started climbing on the tables. Everyone began to chant, "Lesbos! Lesbos! Lesbos!" The words merged into a vague howl before suddenly starting up again, rising into the air, filling the plain beyond, resounding in the dense foliage of the tall surrounding trees, and echoing in the distance as if aimed at the sun itself. During this ovation, the oarswoman had calmly come to a halt. The big blonde, lying at the bottom of the boat, turned to her languorously and raised herself on her elbows. The two in the stern started laughing and waving to the crowd. At this, there was even more of a hubbubaloo, and the place shook with the noise. The men raised their hats, and the women waved their handkerchiefs. Every voice, deep and shrill alike, chanted in unison, "Lesbos!" This motley collection of undesirables seemed to be saluting a leader, as warships give a gun salute to their passing admiral. From the flotilla of boats, also there was a wild acclamation for the women's boat, which now continued at its leisurely pace to a land a little further off. Monsieur Paul's reaction was unlike that of the others. Pulling a key from his pocket, he started using it as a whistle and blew it hard. His girl, looking nervous, now and even paler than before, pulled his arm to make him stop. This time, when she looked into his eyes, it was with fury. But he was beside himself, with male jealousy and a deep, instinctive, ungovernable rage. His lips trembling with indignation, he stammered, "Shouldn't be allowed." They should be drowned like puppies with stones around their necks. Wow, what a dick, Monsieur Paul. Shouldn't be allowed. They should be drowned like puppies with stones around their necks. Madalena suddenly lost her temper. Her shrill voice became piercing as she lashed out at him. Mind your own business, will you? They've got a perfect right to do whatever they want. They're not doing any harm to anyone. Why don't you just shut up and leave them alone? He cut her short. This is a matter for the police. If it was up to me, I'd have them locked up in Saint-Lazare. She gave a start. Oh, you would you? Certainly I would. And in the meantime, I forbid you to have anything to do with them. I absolutely forbid it. Do you understand? She shrugged her shoulders at this and said in a suddenly calm voice, Listen, dear, I shall do exactly as I please. And if you don't like it, you know what you can do. Get the hell out. Now I'm not your wife, so shut up. He remained silent, and they stood staring each other out, breathing rapidly, their mouths set. At the other end of the cafe, the women were now making their entrance. The two dressed as men led one gaunt and weather-beaten, aging and very mannish. The other, more than amply filling the white flannel outfit with her large bottom and her huge thighs encased in the wide trousers, waddled forward like a fat, bow-legged goose. The two friends followed, and the whole boating community surged forward to shake hands. The four had rented a riverside cottage and lived together there as two couples. Their vice was public, official, and perfectly obvious to all. It was referred to, quite naturally, as something entirely normal. There were rumors about jealous scenes that took place there, and about the various actresses and other famous women who frequented the little cottage near the water's edge. One neighbor, scandalized by the goings-on, alerted the police at one stage, and an inspector, accompanied by one of his men, came to make inquiries. It was a delicate mission. There was nothing the women could be prosecuted for, least of all, prostitution. The inspector was deeply puzzled and could not understand what these alleged misdemeanors could possibly be. He asked a whole lot of pointless questions, compiled a lengthy report, and dismissed the charges out of hand. The joke spread as far as Saint Germain. Like queens, they now walked slowly the entire length of La Grenouillère. They seemed happy to be in the limelight, and delighted with the attention paid to them by all this riffraff. Madalena and her lover watched them, and as they approached, the girl's face lit up. When the leading couple reached their table, Madalena cried out, Pauline! And the big girl, turning round, stopped, still arm in arm with her midshipwoman. Well, good heavens! Madalena, darling, come and join us for a bit. We must catch up. Paul tightened his grip on his girl's wrist, but she said, You know what you can do, sweetheart. Shove off. He kept quiet and let her be. Standing huddled together, the women continued their animated conversation. Soto Voki, whatever that is. Pauline from time to time cast furtive glances at Paul and flashed him an evil, sardonic smile. Finally, unable to bear it any minute longer, he suddenly stood up and, trembling in every limb, leapt towards her. He seized Madalena by the shoulders and said, Come with me, do you hear? I said you were not to speak to these beastly women. Raising her voice, Pauline began to swear at him, like a fishwife. People around started laughing. Others stood on tiptoe to get a better look. Under the hail of filthy abuse, he was speechless. Feeling contaminated by it, and fearing there might be worse to come, he retreated, retraced his steps, and went to lean on the balustrade overlooking the river. Turning his back on the three triumphant women, he stayed there looking at the water, and every so often, briskly wiping away the tears that sprang to his eyes. The fact was that despite himself, without knowing why or how it had happened, and very much against his better judgment, he had fallen hopelessly in love. He had fallen as if into some deep and muddy hole. By nature, he was a delicate and sensitive soul. He had had ideals and dreamed of an exquisite and passionate affair. And now he had fallen for this little cricket of a creature. She was as stupid as every other woman, and not even pretty to make up for it. Skinny and foul-tempered. She had taken possession of him entirely, from tip to toe, body and soul. He had fallen under the omnipotent and mysterious spell of the female. He was overwhelmed by this colossal force of unknown origin, the demon in the flesh, capable of hurling the most rational man in the world at the feet of a worthless harlot. There was no way he could explain its fatal and total power. Behind his back, now he could feel something evil brewing. Their laughter pierced his heart. What should he do? He knew very well, but had not the courage. He stared fixedly at the opposite bank, where an angler was fishing, his line perfectly still. All of a sudden, the man jerked out of the water a little silver fish, which wriggled at the end of the line. Twisting and turning it this way and that, he tried to extract his hook, but in vain. Losing patience, he started pulling, and as he did so, tore out the entire bloody gullet of the fish, with parts of its intestines attached. Paul shuddered, feeling himself equally torn apart. It seemed to him that the hook was like his own love, and that if he were to tear it out, he too would be gutted by a piece of curved wire hooked deep into his essential self at the end of a line held by Madalena. Feeling a hand on his shoulder, he started and turned round. Madalena was standing beside him. Neither spoke. She simply put her elbows on the balustrade beside him and leaned with him, staring out at the river. He tried to think of something to say, but failed. He was incapable of analyzing what was going on inside of him. All he felt now was joy in the very nearness of her, and shameful cowardice on his own part. He wanted to forgive her, to let her do anything in the world she liked, provided she never left him again. After a while, in a very gentle voice, he asked, "Would you like to leave now? We'd be better off in the boat." "All right, my pet," she said. Awash with forgiveness and with tears still in his eyes, he held her two hands tightly and helped her board the boat. Basking in the warmth of the afternoon, they rowed upstream again, past the willows and the grass-covered banks. When they reached La Grillion, once more it was now yet six. So, leaving their skiff, they set off on foot towards Bezons, across the meadows and past the high poplars, bording the banks. The wide hayfields, waiting to be harvested, were full of flowers. The sinking sun cast a mantle of roussette light over all, and in the gentle warmth of the day's end, the fragrance of the grass wafted in on them, mingling with the damp smells of the river and filling the air with easy languor and an atmosphere of blessed well-being. He felt soft and unresistant, in communion with the calm splendor of the evening and with the vague, mysterious thrill of life itself. He felt in tune with the all-embracing poetry of the moment, in which plants and all that surrounded him revealed themselves to his senses at this lovely, restful, reflective time of day. He was sensitive to it all, but she appeared totally unaffected. They were walking side by side, when suddenly, bored by the silence, she began to sing. In a squeaky, unmodulated voice, she sang one of the catchy tunes of the day, which jarred violently with the deeply serene mood of the evening. He looked at her and felt, between them, an unbridgeable abyss. She was swinging her parasol through the grass with her head down, looking at her feet as she sang, drawing out the notes and adding the odd little trill. So behind the smooth little brow, which he so much adored, there was nothing, absolutely nothing. Its sole concern at the moment was this caterwauling. The thoughts, which from time to time passed through it, were as vapid as the music. She had no understanding of him. They were as separate and distinct as if they had never met. His kisses had touched her lips only, and nothing deeper within. When, however, she raised her eyes to meet his and smiled, he felt himself melt. Opening his arms out wide to her, in a surge of renewed love, he clasped her passionately to him. Since he was crushing her dress as he did so, she eventually broke free, saying consolingly, "Yes, yes, I love you, my pet. Now that's enough." In a mad rush of relief, he grabbed her round the waist and started to run, dragging her with him. He kissed her on the cheeks, the temples, and the neck, all the time dancing with joy. They threw themselves down at the edge of the thicket, incandescent in the light of the setting sun. Even before catching their breath, they came together. She could not understand the rapture he felt. Walking back, hand in hand, they suddenly saw through the trees the river, and on it the boat containing the four women. Big Pauline must have caught sight of them at the same time, since she straightened up, blew kisses at Maddalena, and shouted, "See you tonight!" "See you tonight!" shouted Maddalena in reply. Paul felt his heart turn suddenly to ice. They returned for dinner and settled down in one of the arbors at the side of the water. They began to eat in silence. When darkness fell, a candle enclosed in a globe was brought, which shed a feeble glimmering light on the two. All the time they could hear bursts of laughter coming from the large room on the first floor where the boat trippers were. The couple were just about to order dessert when Paul, taking Maddalena's hand tenderly in his own, said, "Darling, I feel so tired. Shall we make an early night of it?" But she saw through this little ploy and shot him an enigmatic glance, one of those treacherous looks that so often appear in women's eyes. She thought for a second, then said, "You're perfectly welcome to go to bed if you like, but I've promised to go to the dance at Le Grenouillère." Attempting to mask his misery, he gave her a pitiful smile and answered in a coaxing, wheedling tone, "Be a darling. Let's both stay here, please." She shook her head without saying a word. He tried again, "Please, sweetheart." She cut him off. "You know what I said. If you're not happy, you know where the door is. Nobody's stopping you. But I've promised, and I'm going." He put his two elbows on the table, sank his head into his hands, and sat brooding. The trippers were coming down the stairs, yelling as usual, before setting off for the dance at Le Grillonaire. Maddalena said to Paul, "Make up your mind. If you're not coming, I'll ask one of these gentlemen to take me there." Paul rose. "Come on, then," he muttered before they too set off. The night was dark and the sky full of stars. Around them the air was still hot and the atmosphere heavy with seething, unseen activity. The warm breeze caressed their faces, its hot breath stifling their own and making them gasp slightly. The skiff set off, each with a Venetian lantern in the prow. It was too dark to see anything of the boats themselves, except for the little patches of color in the night, bobbing and dancing like frenzied glowworms. Voices sounded from the shadows on all sides as the young couple's skiff glided gently along. Sometimes, when another overtook, they would catch the flash of the oarsman's white jersey, white-jerseyed back, illuminated by his lantern. As they came round the bend of the river, La Grulinaire came into sight in the distance. In a gala mood, the place was decorated with bunting and with strings, clusters and garlands of fairy lights. On the surface of the Seine, large barges moved slowly about, representing domes, pyramids, and all kinds of monuments, picked out in variously colored lights. Illuminated festoons hung down as far as the water itself, and here and there, an enormous red or blue lantern, suspended from an invisible rod, hung like a huge star in the sky. All these illuminations shone on the cafe and the floodlight, the great trees on the bank, whose trunks stood out pale gray and whose leaves were milky green against the deep pitch black of the fields and of the sky. A band consisting of five local players blared shrill, syncopated music across the water, and hearing it, Madalena began to sing along. She wanted to go in right away. Paul would have preferred to make a tour of the island first, but had to give in. The clientele had thinned out a little by this time, still consisting mostly of boatmen with the odd sprinkling of middle-class couples and a few young men flanked by girls. The director and the organizer of the can-can strutted in his faded black suit and cast round the audience the world-weary, professional eye of a cheap music hall master of ceremonies. Paul was relieved to see that Big Pauline and her chums were nowhere to be seen. People were dancing, couples faced each other, and capered about madly, kicking their legs as high as their partners' noses. The women who appeared to have double-jointed legs and hips leapt about in a frou-frou of lifted skirts, flashing their knickers and kicking their legs up over their heads with amazing agility. They wriggled their bellies and shook their bosoms, spreading about them the powerful smell of female flesh and sweat. Holy fuck. Let's read that sentence again. They wriggled their bellies and shook their bosoms, spreading about them the powerful smell of female flesh and sweat. The males squatted like toads in front of them, making faces and obscene gestures. They cavorted and turned cartwheels, posturing meanwhile in hideous parody as one strapping maid and two waiters served the audience drinks. Since the cafe boat was covered by a roof only and had no sidewalls to separate it from the outdoors, the whole rumbustuous dance was performed against the backdrop of the peaceful night and a firmament dusted with stars. Suddenly, Mont Valérien in the distance lit up as if a fire had started behind it. The glow deepened and spread, describing a wide, luminous circle of pale light. Then a ruby-colored shape appeared, grew large, and glowed like a red-hot metal. The circle widened further, still, and seemed to be emerging from the earth itself, as the moon, breaking free of the horizon, sailed gently towards, upwards, into space. As it rose, its crimson glow dimmed and turned into an increasingly light, then bright yellow. As the planet climbed higher, it grew smaller and smaller in the distance. Paul, lost in long contemplation of the sight, had become oblivious to his girl. When he turned round, she had disappeared from view. He looked for her in vain, having searched anxiously and systematically up and down the rows of tables. He started asking people. No one had seen her. He then began to wander about wretchedly until one of the waiters said, "If you're looking for Madame Madalena, she went off a little while ago with Madame Pauline." Simultaneously, he caught sight of the midshipwoman. the two beautiful girls and two beautiful girls sitting at the opposite end of the cafe, arms round each other's waists, watching him and whispering. Realizing what had happened, he ran off like a madman towards the island, chasing first in the direction of Chateau. He stopped at the edge of the plain, turned and retraced his steps. He began to search the dense coppices, wandering about aimlessly and stopping every so often to listen. All he could hear around him was the short metallic croak of frogs. Towards Bougainville, an unfamiliar bird sang a song which reached him faintly from a distance. Over the broad fields, the moon shed a soft, filmy light. It filtered through the foliage, silvering the barks of the poplars and casting a shower of brilliant moonbeams on the shimmering tops of the tallest trees. Despite himself, Paul was enchanted by the intoxicating loveliness of the night. It penetrated the terrible anguish he was feeling and stirred in his heart a fierce sense of irony. He longed with all his gentle and idealistic soul for a faithful woman to worship, someone whose arms he could express all his love, someone in whose arms he could express all his love and tenderness as well as his passion. Fuck, let's read that again. Despite himself, Paul was enchanted by the intoxicating loveliness of the night. It penetrated the terrible anguish he was feeling and stirred in his heart a fierce sense of irony. He longed with all his gentle and idealistic soul for a faithful woman to worship, someone in whose arms he could express all his love and tenderness as well as his passion. Choked by racking sobs, he had to stop in his tracks. Having recovered a little, he went on, only to feel a sudden stab in his heart. There, behind that bush, a pair of lovers. He ran forward and saw their silhouettes united in a seemingly endless kiss before they quickly ran off at his approach. He dared not call out, knowing full well that his own girl would not respond. He was desperately afraid now of coming upon them all of a sudden. The music of the quadrilles with its piercing solo cornets, the mock gaiety of the flute, and the scraping of the fiddles pulled at his own heartstring and deepened the pain he continued to feel. Suddenly it occurred to him that she might have gone back in. Yes, that was it. She must have returned. He had lost all sense of proportion. He was stupid. He had been carried away by all the silly suspicions and fears that always haunted him. In one of those periods of strange calm which occur during periods of the blackest despair, he turned and began to make for the cafe again. He took in the whole room at a single glance. She was not there. He checked all the tables and once again came face to face with the three women. He must have looked the picture of dejection, for the three burst out laughing. Rushing out again, he ran back to the island. He threw himself into the coppices and stopped to listen once more. It was some time before he could hear anything save the roaring in his own ears. Finally, however, he thought he could hear some way ahead a shrill little laugh he knew only too well. Creeping forward, he fell to his knees and crawled on, parting the branches cautiously as he went. You got that? He's crawling through the woods towards the sound. His heart was beating so wildly in his chest that he could hardly breathe. Two voices were murmuring. He could not make out what they were saying. Then they fell silent again. He had a sudden furious desire to run away, not to see, not to know, and to keep on running to escape from the raging passion with which he was consumed. He would return to Chateau, catch a train, and never come back. He would never see her again. Just as suddenly, her face appeared in his mind's eyes. He saw her as she was waking up next to him. in their warm bed. He saw her snuggle up to him and throw her arms around his neck. Her hair was loose and a little tangle over her brow. Her eyes were still closed and her lips parted, waiting for the first kiss of the day. The thought of this morning's embrace filled him with unbearable regret and frantic desire. They were talking again. He approached, bent double. Then a cry rose from under the branches close to him. That cry. It was one of those he had come to know from their most tender, their most passionate lovemaking. He crept even closer, drawn irresistibly, blindingly, despite himself. And then he saw them. Oh, if only the other person had been a man. But this, he was transfixed by that loathsome sight before him. He remained there, overwhelmed by shock. It was as though he had just stumbled upon the mutilated body of a loved one. It was a crime against nature, a monstrous and wicked desecration. Suddenly flashing into his mind's eye, this time came the image of the little fish whose entrails he had earlier seen ripped out. Madalena was moaning, "Pauline," exactly as she used to moan, "Paul," to him. Hearing it, he felt such pain that he turned and fled. He hurtled into one tree and ricocheted into another, fell over a root, picking himself up and ran again until suddenly he found himself at the edge of the river. The raging torrent made whirls and eddies on which the moonbeams now played. On the opposite side of the bank loomed over the water like a cliff, leaving a wide band of black at its foot from which the sound of the swirling water rose in the darkness. Clearly visible on the other side were the weekend homes of Crossy. Paul saw all this as if in a dream, or as something remembered. He was no longer thinking. He understood nothing now. Everything, including his own existence, seemed vague, distant, forgotten, finished. There was the river. Did he know what he was doing? Did he want to die? He had lost his mind. Nevertheless, he turned round to face the island where she was. In the night in which the faint but persistent beat of the dance band still throbbed back and forth, he shouted, "Madalena!" His heart-rending call pierced the great silence of the sky and echoed, lost in the distance. Then, with a furious, animal-like leap, he plunged into the river. The water splashed, then closed over the spot, setting up a series of ever-widening circles, which rippled in the moonlight as far as the opposite bank. The two women had heard. Madalena got up and said, "That's Paul." A suspicion arose suddenly in her mind. "He's drowned himself," she said, and rushed towards the bank, where Pauline caught up with him. A heavy punt with two men in it was circling over and over around the same spot. One of the men rowed, while the other was plunging a long pole into the water, evidently looking for something. Pauline shouted, "What's happened? What are you doing?" A stranger's voice cried, "A man's just drowned himself." With haggard faces, the two women huddled together and watched the boat's maneuvers. The music from La Roulinaire, pounding in the distance, provided a grim counterpoint to the movements of the solemn fishermen. The river, now containing a corpse in its depths, continued to swirl in the moonlight. The search was prolonged, and Madalena, waiting in horrible suspense, shivered. Finally, after a good half hour, one of the men announced, "I've got him!" Very gradually, he pulled in the boat hook. A large mass appeared at the surface of the water. The other boatman left his oars, and between the two, each heaving with all his strength, they managed to haul the inert body and bring it tumbling into the boat. They soon reached the bank. and found an open flat space in the moonlight. As they landed, the women approached. As soon as she saw him, Madalena recoiled in horror. In the light of the moon's rays, he looked green already, and his mouth, his eyes, his nose, and his clothes were full of the river's slime. The stiff fingers of his clenched fist looked hideous, black, liquid silt covered his entire body. The face looked swollen, and from his hair, now plastered down with ooze, a stream of filthy water ran. The two men examined him. "You know him?" asked one. The other, the crossy ferryman, hesitated. "Seems to me I know his face," he said, "but it's difficult to tell seeing him like this." Then suddenly, "Oh, I know, it's Monsieur Paul." "Who's Monsieur Paul?" his friend asked. The first went on, "You know, Monsieur Paul Baron, son of that senator, that kid who was so hooked on that girl. You remember?" The other added philosophically, "No more girls for him now, eh? Poor sod, and with all that money, too." Madalena, having collapsed on the ground, was sobbing. Pauline approached the body and said, "I suppose he really is dead. There's no chance he might..." The men shrugged their shoulders. "At that length of time, no question." And one of them asked, "Was he staying at La Grillion?" "Yes," said the other. "We better take him back there." "Handsome tip, mate." Re-embarking, they set off, moving slowly across the rapid current. Long after they had disappeared, the two women's sight, the regular sound of their oars, could still be heard. Pauline took poor, weeping Madalena in her arms, kissed and rocked her for a long time, and then said, "Now look, as long as you know it's not your fault, you can't stop men doing stupid things. It was his decision, so it's just too bad, that's all." Then lifting her to her feet, she added, "Come on, darling, come and sleep at my house. You can't go back to La Grillienne tonight." She kissed her again. "Come on, you'll feel better with us," she said. Madalena got up, still sobbing, but less violently. She leaned her head on Pauline's shoulder, seeming to find there a safer, warmer refuge and a closer, more intimate affection. She walked slowly away from the scene. Wow. Well, that's a good way to end a podcast. Guy killing himself over a lesbian joyous experience. Well, what can I say? That's today's podcast, ladies and gentlemen. The mind of Guy de Maupassant. Femme fatale. Wow, what a story. Poor Paul. Dumb schmuck. I'm as dazed as I was when I read the story about the woman offering her breast milk filled breast to the carpenter on the train. Some of these stories just, you know, they're so powerful. They knock you out and stay in your brain forever. I love his imagery of summer and the smells and the odors and just human drama of it all. So that's my Guy de Maupassant episode that I've wanted to do for you for a long time. The next episode I'm going to do is going to be from Mongolia. Speaking of summer, I'm going to go back to Mongolia and ride horses and sleep in a gur. And I'm going to do a show in Ulaanbaatar on August 22nd. And then, what is it? I'm doing a gig in Beijing and then Shanghai. The first 2 weeks of September, I'm in Chicago at Zany's. The last weekend of September, I am at the Punchline in Atlanta. And then all of October, I'm going to be in Europe. And then first Saturday in November, I'm in Berlin. And got a really great couple of months coming up. I hope I can see you and embrace you. And hopefully you're having a much better, happier summer. Hopefully you're having like the lesbian in the boathouse summer and not Paul at the bottom of the river summer. Hopefully some woman with a large milk-filled breast on a train offers one to you. So I end this podcast with offering you a happy summer breast. Yeah, that was weird. Anyway, shalom, amigos. E, amigas. This was a nice long episode. Happy summertime to you.
Jadis, ça m'écorche la bouche, me froisse les pupilles.